Episode 2232, My Strength is My Story with Allison Fallon, The Power of Writing It Down.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo. Staring at
a stop sign. Happy every day. I hope you're having a beautiful week. Today is my favorite day of the week. It is My Strength is My Story series, and we have with us a writer in the house. Yes, she has published a book, but Allison Fallon is much more than this. I'm telling you right now, how you look at words and writing is going to be totally different after this episode. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends and family of Allison's, welcome to our family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already didn't have the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com, where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple Strategy, Everyday Solutions to Live, Love, and Impact. Well, I am absolutely excited. I want you to listen to this episode all the way to the end. And I got to tell you this. You might be thinking, gosh, do I have to be a writer to really love this episode? Oh, no. This episode is going to take you on an incredible life's journey in a very short period of time, and you're going to love it. Yes, maybe you are a writer, and you feel like, when I have a blank page, what do? We talk about that. We're also going to talk about, though, everyday life. What would it be like if you knew you could take a simple habit to unlock your brain and reimagine your life? Without further ado, let's welcome in Allison Fallon, The Power of Writing It Down. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I'm so excited. We have, well, let's see, what would I call her? She's just an all-around exquisite writer is what I would call her. It's Allison Fallon. She's the wife of 1 year to her husband, Matt. Yes, they're newlyweds. How adorable. And she's a mom to a brand new five-month-old baby girl. I know their house is just full of joy and love right now. She is a speaker and founder of Find Your Voice, a community that supports anyone who wants to write anything. Allison has helped leaders of multinational corporations, stay-at-home moms, Olympic gold medalists, recovering addicts, political figures, CEOs, and prison inmates, just to name a few, use Find Your Voice method as a powerful tool to generate positive change in their lives. She is also an author of Packing Light and Indestructible, publishing 13 books. Can you count them? 13. You need more than just two hands to count how many. But her latest book is The Power of Writing It Down, a simple habit to unlock your brain and reimagine your life. Welcome, my friend. How are you, Allie?
I'm great. That's quite the introduction. I'm really honored to be here.
Well, it is, but it's your life. And so, you know, it's amazing though when you listen back to it.
It's true.
And you walk through with a lot of people that way. They share their stories with you. Yeah. You have ghostwritten books. And so you know what it's like to have people share their life with you. But then when you give it back to them, it's like, whoa, that's really my life. It's pretty awakening.
Honestly, this is the greatest power of the writing process is exactly that. When you write down your story, even if you don't ever share it with anyone, just the act of seeing it on the page helps you have that perspective that you're talking about, where you're seeing your life from the outside of it, which most of us don't ever take the time to do. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty powerful. And a lot of us don't know how to kind of remove ourselves because we're in the middle of it. And we don't take time because we're too busy, and we were busy as a badge of honor. And if we would just stop to breathe, which I know you have because you got married, you got a baby girl, what brings you joy?
Oh, my daughter brings me joy. Yesterday, my husband was playing with the dog, and she thought whatever he was doing with the dog was so funny and just got going with those baby giggles, you know, like just like the pure, innocent, guttural laughter. And I was just like, I could die happy. This is the happiest I've ever been in my whole life, listening to my daughter laugh.
It is the most precious thing in the world. And just savor up those moments, because pretty soon they just get louder and they want more from you. They're different giggles. They're more like, come on, mom, now bring it on. But it is such a blessing. Well, you are a writer. You've published 13 books. Where did your love of writing begin?
I can remember as early as fourth grade. When I talk about when I fell in love with writing, I tell a story of a time when my fourth grade teacher gave us an assignment to write a story. It could be a story about anything. And I went away that night and at home for homework, wrote out my story. And when I came back the next day to turn it into my teacher, I noticed that my classmates had written, you know, half a page, maybe three quarters of a page. Some of them had written a page if they were really overachievers. And just out of the sheer passion of it, I had written 9 pages front and back with like these really vivid details. And my teacher noticed, obviously, the discrepancy in how much time and energy I had put into this. And she loved the story so much that I read that she had me read it in front of the class. And it was the first time in my life that I ever remember feeling very good at anything. I don't know if listeners can resonate with that, but just that feeling when you're like, oh, I have like a gift here. I have a talent here. And at the end of that school year, she handed me a journal and wrote a little note to me on the front cover of the journal that just said, like, you know, dear Allison, you're a great writer. Please keep writing. And all summer, I wrote in the pages of that journal, filled up every single page. I asked my mom to go get me another one. And that was the start of a long love story with writing. I wrote, you know, notes to myself, little poems, just kind of like stream of consciousness, like free writes style, journaling style for all my life until high school and college. And up until now, it's led me into this career that I'm doing now.
That's incredible. And it started just at such a young age. There is something about going back to our childhood and bringing back that childlike spirit within us. You open up your first chapter writing about the stories that we have to tell, ideas you have to share, but we don't like them very much. And we really don't express ourselves. The first question you ask, and I want to ask you, what is the cost of holding back what is trying to be expressed through you?
Well, I can answer this question from personal experience because I've lived through a lot of seasons in my life where I was holding back what was trying to be expressed through me. And the cost is really, you know, the first thing that comes to mind is physical pain, that for much of my life, I experienced the ways that I was holding myself back creatively as I experienced them in my physical body. So one really poignant example of this is for over a decade in my life, I dealt with crippling food allergies. So there were like, you know, I was in and out of doctor's appointments, kind of trying to figure out like what was going on with my body, but my body was just shutting down. There were just so many foods that my body wouldn't process. And I was diagnosed at one point with a, this kind of seems like a tangent, but I promise it all connects. I was diagnosed with what the doctors called dietary fructose intolerance, meaning for whatever reason, my body wasn't processing fructose. Well, fructose is not only high fructose corn syrup is in literally everything. And this is also back in like 2004, maybe that I was diagnosed with this. And so it was before there was a lot of awareness around ingredients in food. So everything I was eating had high fructose corn syrup in it. But then also fructose is like the basic makeup structure of fruit and vegetables. So the doctor's answer to solve my problems was cut out all fruit and cut out any vegetables that are red, yellow, or orange, because that's how you can tell whether a vegetable has fructose in it. So I did that. I abided by that diet for a long period of time and saw a reduction in my symptoms. And then I started to see the symptoms come again. Long story short, I worked with a naturopath who also had me cut out gluten, but you can kind of see what was happening. Like I was like cutting out all these foods and I could see the symptoms go away. But I also didn't have a lot of freedom to like move around in my life. I couldn't go to a restaurant. I couldn't go to dinner at a friend's house. It was like, I was always the problem. It was so complicated everywhere I went. And I started working with a therapist and with my own writing practice to ask myself the question, what might my food allergies be telling me? What might my body be telling me through these food allergies? And this is a much longer story that I share on my blog. I talk about, you know, I think the title of the blog post is like the greatest miracle I ever experienced. But I talk about, you know, when I started to answer that question for myself, my body told me the truth. You know, it told me that what was going on, there was a handful of different things that were going on. But the writing process helped me unlock what was going on and helped me deal with the emotional problems that were in the end causing these physical symptoms. So what I tell writers all the time as they're working through these processes, just because you've gotten a diagnosis from Western medicine, it doesn't mean the diagnosis is wrong. You know, I mean, my doctor was right. When I cut out fructose, I stopped seeing the symptoms. But there may be more layers to the story than we realize. And if you're willing to, you know, tap into that emotional connection through a tool like writing, sometimes you can find a way to actually heal your physical body so that now I can eat whatever I want.
Wow. That is incredible. And I'm so excited that you shared that story, because we could just go off on what you just shared there, because you and I have more in common than what you think. And it is about food. And we'll just have to have you back so we can just talk all about that story. Seriously. Because it is incredible. But knowing that you experienced this, the cost of it was part of your life, that freedom that you had to live. You know, that's a cost that most of us don't want to give up. Why do you think we love the United States of America so much? Is because of our freedom. And when something strips us of that freedom, well, then we feel confined. We feel imprisoned. Your title of your book is The Power of Writing It Down. What's the secret behind that title?
The secret really is, I teach some brain science in the book, even though I'm not a neuroscientist. And, you know, I talk about in the book, I know just enough about this to be dangerous. But what I talk about is that the act of writing, the act of picking up the pen and putting that pen to a piece of paper, helps you access a part of our brain that we don't access very often. It's a different part of your brain than you access when you're communicating verbally. So you might ask me a question here and I'm going to tell you an answer. But if I were to ask myself the same question and sit down and write about it or journal about it, I'm probably going to come up with a different answer than I would when I'm just talking out loud to you. And it doesn't mean that we're not being honest with ourselves or we're not being honest with other people. It means that there are a lot of thoughts, ideas, beliefs, dreams that we have in our subconscious minds that we aren't aware of on a daily basis. And writing is this tool that gives us access to those things. So the power of that really is, for all of us, we have things about our life that we wish were different, right? Like, just, they might be like really minor things that you wish were different. Like, I wish I had like more time and space in my schedule every day. Or maybe there are major things that we wish were different. Like maybe, you know, my romantic partnership, my husband and or my wife, or, you know, the most important partnership in my life doesn't feel like a healthy partnership to me. And that's something I really would like to change. Or, you know, I feel like I'm a really angry parent and I lose my temper all the time. And I see how this is having an impact on my kids. And I really wish that this would change. Whatever it is that you wish would change for you, this is a great time to talk about this at the beginning of the year, because we all set these New Year's resolutions in place and we have our goals of how we want to be different. And we're like, new year, new me. And yet, as we set off to accomplish these things, we can bump into some obstacles. And we find that changing our behavior is actually a lot harder than we thought it was. The power of writing is that when you can tap into the subconscious mind, you can find the thoughts, feelings, and beliefs that are actually driving your daily behavior. So most of us approach goal setting and approach New Year's resolutions with the higher level executive functioning part of our brain called our prefrontal cortex. And actually, that's not the part of our brain that's going to be most effective at changing those things about us, because most of our behavior comes from those hidden subconscious beliefs and ideas. The power of writing is it helps us access that deeper, lower part of our brain called our limbic system, so that we can pull those thoughts and ideas up into our frontal cortex so that we can actually see a tangible change in the way that our lives play out. So if you're anyone who's, if you're feeling stuck in any way, if you've tried to change your behavior and you're frustrated that you're not able to, writing is an incredible tool that you can use to start to unpack what's actually going on beneath the surface.
Okay, that was jam-packed of everything. That's why everybody's going to want to pick up their own copy of The Power of Writing It Down, a simple habit to unlock your brain and reimagine your life. Well, speaking of your book, you write, and I want to quote this because I think it's really important. So I'm going to read from your book. It says, writing is prayer, spirituality, self-discovery, communication, therapy, connection. The invitation and impulse to write is not just an invitation and impulse to put a few words down on the page. It's an invitation to take our ownership of our lives. Writing helps us gain confidence in ourselves, our ideas, and how we move through the world. The invitation to write is an invitation to find your voice. What has been your experience in finding your voice?
Well, the biggest epiphany for me happened several years ago. Most people who follow me know this, but I was married before. I was married to a pastor, actually. We planted a church together. And about 4 years into our marriage, I uncovered a whole host of pieces of information that just let me know that I had not been told the truth. There were a lot of things that were kept from me throughout the marriage. Now, if you ask me now, I would tell you I kind of knew the whole time. I wouldn't have told you that at the time. However, my intuition was definitely telling me that there was something off about our relationship. I didn't have the confidence to say what I was thinking. I didn't have the confidence to speak the truth when I was in that relationship. So when I uncovered what I uncovered and my whole life came crumbling down and I, you know, my marriage ended, we were business partners together. So I lost my business. I lost my house. I lost my dog. I lost everything that I thought was my life was ripped out from underneath of me in a matter of a couple of weeks. While I was in that process, I decided that this, this tool that I had been using to teach other people to tell their personal stories, perhaps I could use it to tell my own personal story. So I sat down to write the story of my marriage and my divorce. And the way that I thought this was going to go in the beginning is I thought I was going to like tell every dirty secret and all these secrets that I've been keeping for so long. I was going to finally let them out in the open. And, you know, he was going to be really sorry. And I was going to finally get to like speak my truth. And when I sat down to write the story, I realized that that was actually a really uninteresting version of the story, where the story was all about him and it wasn't anything about me. So what unfolded for me as I was writing out the story is I realized if I'm the main character of the story, like if this is a story of my life and I'm the protagonist, then the story hinges on me. The question is not, why did he do this to me? Or how could this have happened to me? The question is, what am I going to do next? I mean, think of like the opening scene of a movie, right? Like we know really clearly in the opening scene of a movie who the main character is, what problem they're facing, the obstacles that are in their way. And what we're all wondering as the audience, as we're sitting there, is how's she going to overcome this? What's she going to do with this hand that's been dealt to her? So as I started to write my story and started to think about it that way, I realized that I had so much more power to shape my circumstances than I had ever realized. And that even though I hadn't picked this reality that I had been given, there was a lot that I could do to be the kind of woman that I wanted to be, to live with integrity, to make, you know, really complicated, complex decisions that were going to affect the rest of my life, but to make them with confidence and to know that this was how, you know, this was the kind of woman I wanted to be and this is how I wanted to live my life. So it really reshaped the way that I saw myself in the story. I went from seeing myself as a kind of a victim in the story, like, oh, this is so terrible. How could this happen to me? What am I supposed to do now? Now I'm 30 years old and I'm starting from scratch, to being like, I'm a powerful woman who knows what I want. I know what I'm about. I know what I deserve. I know what I'm worth. And I'm going to make that happen for myself. So it really gave me this like confidence and strength. When I say voice, the first thing that comes to mind is like using your actual voice to speak a truth, which is definitely part of it. But for me, it was so much more about how I embodied myself. It was more like how I moved through the world, that I didn't have to wonder, like, should I be friends with that person or not? It became really clear to me who I wanted in my life. I wanted people in my life who made me better, you know, who push me, who support me unconditionally, who love me despite my flaws. And I didn't want people in my life who were going to criticize me or bully me or manipulate me or use me for their own purposes. So it just started to make those types of decisions way more clear. And as I carried myself through the world like that, that's what I would classify as finding your voice. It's a, you know, a way to carry yourself where you don't question what your value is or why you matter.
Thank you, sister, for sharing that. I know you just opened up a heart for someone to hear something greater that may not even have anything to do with actual writing, but the idea that you came from something so hurtful, and our earthly hurt is pain. I mean, it hurts and it's hard to get over that. But for you, how you took the power of writing, pen to paper, how you began to say, you know what? I can't keep throwing the blame at somebody else. I got to be the one to start owning the story because I can only take care of me. And it just has opened up an incredible world for you. And Allison, thank you. I sincerely mean that.
Thank you for saying that.
There are a lot of people hurting. What we've come out of, you know, from 2020, what we're going into now from 2021, there is so many balls up in the air right now. Nobody knows what's going on. But just what you teach here and what you write, your book is so jam-packed. And I read a lot of books. Almost every other page, I'm marking it up with a highlighter.
And, I love that.
And by the way, this was bonus material for those of you who are listening because it's not in her book exactly. There's somewhere else I'm sure you could find it because she's written other books. Okay, so moving back on what you said, you could have got hung up on where you were and you wouldn't be where you are right now. You wouldn't have that blessed little 5-month-old little girl looking at you just full of giggles right now. And there's nothing she can do right now that can make you mad because she's just so little. Now, a couple more months, we'll have a different discussion.
Yeah.
But we get trapped in our own stuff. And you talk about this feeling as a hang-up. Describe what you mean by that.
The hang-up is just that feeling you have where something is off. So it's the feeling that I was talking about in my marriage before I knew what was really going on, but I had a sense that something was not right, that the way he talked to me was not right, the way he treated me was not right. There was something going on that I didn't, that I wasn't being told. It's just like a sense that something's off. And in that example, it's kind of a dramatic example, but I think a lot of times in our lives, we can have a sense that something's off, and it doesn't have to be anything crazy dramatic, but it just might be, it might mean that like you're in a job that is done for you. Like it's time for you to move on to a new thing. Or, you know, it might mean like a friendship in your life needs a new boundary or something like that. But I think we talk ourselves out of having that feeling a lot of times by saying things like, well, you know, I have it pretty great. I ought to just be more grateful. I ought to just like, you know, count my blessings and kind of look around my life and realize that like I have a lot of things that other people don't have. And so what am I complaining about? I should just move on. And the thing I encourage people to do is, you know, this, the hang up, that feeling that something is off is your intuition trying to tell you something. So do not ignore that intuition. The worst thing we can do is ignore it. And the best thing we can do is actually through a practice like writing, give it permission to speak to us. So, you know, I talked about with my food allergies, giving that voice permission to speak to me and tell me what was really going on with my body. Through my marriage, telling, you know, the end of my last marriage, through telling the story and giving my voice permission to speak to me and tell me what my next step was and what I needed to do and how I was, who I wanted to be in the world. We can use this process with literally anything. If you're feeling, you know, like it's time for you to move on from your job, or if you're feeling like a friendship needs to shift, or I don't know, an infinite number of other examples, it could be something small, like I mentioned, then you can use a tool like writing to allow that part of yourself to have a voice and to speak to you and to give you the information that it needs you to hear.
Oh, that's awesome. Well, for the ones who are willing to give writing a shot or who call themselves writers, what would you tell them when all they see is a blank page?
The blank page can be pretty intimidating, but the biggest piece of advice that I have is to, as much as it is possible for you, try to remove this idea that we have about writing, that we have to come to the page all buttoned up. So a lot of times people have, our ideas around the writing process come mostly, I think, from the way we were taught about writing in the education system, which is like, you know, we have to get the grammar perfect and we have to get the spelling perfect and a teacher is going to like mark this thing up and give us a grade at the end of it. And, you know, we got to write it like a 5-paragraph essay or it's got to be a persuasive paper or whatever. And we can kind of get in our heads and just get really hung up on sort of like how the writing comes out. But if you can unwind that a little bit and talk yourself out of needing for it to be perfect or needing it to be great grammar or anything else, and just come to the page with an open mind and a willingness to put a couple of words on the page. It could look like bullet points. It could look like, you know, a bunch of scribbles and then one big word across the middle of the page. It could look like a simple note to yourself. I do this a lot at the beginning of the day. I'll write down note to self and then see what comes next. It could look like a big question that you're trying to get answered in your life right now. Just ask the question, huge question mark, you know, sometimes I'll like circle it and then let your subconscious brain do the work of answering the question for you. So it doesn't have to be anything complex or complicated. You don't have to write for an hour at a time. You don't have to get the grammar perfect. In fact, I say all the time, good writing is not good grammar. Good writing is good thinking. So if you can bring your curiosity to the page, your creativity, your willingness to see things from a different perspective, then you're in a really good spot. You do not need to have, you know, all your I's dotted and T's crossed.
I love that. Good writing is good thinking. I got to think more. Well, after we get past that blank page and some words appear, there still seems to be that cry of, I'm stuck. Mm-hmm. Why do you think we are really stuck?
Well, I say in the book that writer's block is not really writer's block. It's life block. And I think when we get stuck on the page, what it's really showing us is that there's something we want to say or do that we feel we cannot say or do. So let me give you an example, right? Toward the very end of my first marriage, in the last month that we were married, I was working on a new book. I had been contracted to write a book that was all about marriage. The book was called Our First Years, and it was supposed to be this redemptive story about how our first years of marriage had been so hard and we had been through this long struggle together, but we had come out much stronger on the other side. And I would sit down to write this book every day in my life, and I would put my fingers on the keys and just nothing would come. Or I would write like 2,000 words and come away and be like, that's total crap. I can't share that with anyone. So I was doing this over and over again, day after day after day, until finally I uncovered this information, changed everything in my life. My whole marriage fell apart. And it wasn't until later that I looked back that I realized the reason I was stuck in writing a book about my marriage is because I wasn't telling the truth. The truth was my marriage had not transformed. It had not been changed. It was still the same way that it had always been. And I had just found a way to adapt and to kind of live inside of it without, you know, getting clobbered every day. So that's why I was stuck in the writing. It's not because I couldn't think of the words to say. It's because there was something I wanted to do, something I wanted to say that I didn't feel that I could do or say. And really, in my case, I'll be really blunt. What I wanted to do was I wanted to leave him. And I didn't feel that I could leave him because I had been raised in the church and we were in the church. And I felt like I was going to receive a lot of criticism and pushback. And I didn't feel like I had like a, you know, at the time, like a biblical reason to leave him. Because I didn't know what I found out later. So whatever information I uncovered felt like it gave me that kind of a reason. But, you know, if to someone else, this is a side note, but I'm going to say it because I feel like someone might need to hear this. There are so many women who are in abusive relationships in the church. If statistics are correct, something like 30% of partnerships will experience physical violence in the partnership in the lifetime of the partnership. This does not include emotional, spiritual abuse. It doesn't include more subtle forms of manipulation and control. So what I know to be true is there are huge numbers of women in the church who are in relationships that are abusive. That doesn't mean if you're in a relationship that's abusive that you need to immediately get divorced necessarily. But if there's a woman listening who feels like she's in a relationship where she's not being treated the way she deserves to be treated, what I would say to her is that's a biblical reason to get divorced if you want to get divorced, or to call a therapist or call a friend or find a safe way to get out or whatever else that you need to do, depending on the details of the situation. So I just wanted to say that. I know that's kind of a side note and it's not about writing, but it's something I'm really passionate about.
Well, and it's a very important side note, Allison. And that's what you're here. I mean, You write because you have things that you want to say and share. And this is part of your story and who you are. This book that I know people are going to want to pick up, The Power of Writing It Down, is just a glimpse into really what God has been creating in your life, how he has continued to bless you in furthering, not only sharing your story, but also sharing other stories. We do get in ruts. We get stuck. How do you think writing can pull us out of that and begin to reimagine our lives differently?
Hmm. How long do you have?
I can be here all day, girl.
Okay, perfect. So when you get in a rut, when you feel stuck, what's actually happening in your brain, and I teach this a little bit in the book, but what's actually happening in your brain is you're stuck in what's called a neural pathway. My like very elementary explanation of this is, you know, you have an experience in your life, your body's receiving that experience in a certain way. One neuron travels to another neuron, which creates a cocktail of chemicals in your body, which creates a physical sensation about that thing that you just experienced. And your body memorizes that path. So let's just say, for example, driving along the street, a driver drives by you, cuts you off, flips you off. When you have that experience, you think a thought, which is actually like one neuron traveling to another neuron, which creates a cocktail of chemicals in your body, which makes you feel a certain way. Maybe that way is like, maybe the thought you have is like, what an idiot or something like that. And then the feeling that you have in your body is like a rush of anger or frustration. So that connection becomes memorized and those neural pathways will literally fire over and over and over again. The situation may change, but the neural pathway stays the same. So some guy cuts you off in traffic and you feel that same sensation, or your spouse says something kind of snarky to you and you feel that same sensation, or your kid throws a block across the room and you feel that same sensation. So you see how like these neural pathways, they're like, you know, they're firing again and again and again. And just like if you were to ski down a ski slope on the same track multiple times, the track would get deeper and deeper and deeper. And the more times you do that, the harder it is to leave that track and make a new track in the snow. Same thing is true for our neural pathways. So when you're feeling stuck in your life, in case this is interesting to anyone else the way that it is to me, what's actually happening is you're stuck in a neural pathway. You're stuck in a rut in your brain. So what we have to do is figure out what the rut is, how your brain made the connection in the first place, and unwind that connection so that we can carve a new neural pathway and make that the new memorized emotion. But just imagine if your memorized emotion when someone wrongs you or hurts you could be like compassion. Imagine if that could be the memorized expression that you have in your body when someone wrongs you. You know, it takes us some work to get there, but we can get there. Imagine if the memorized response in your body when someone tried to take advantage of you was boundaries. For so many of us, the memorized expression in our body when someone tries to take advantage of us is comply. And so we get ourselves in these relationships where over and over again, we're being taken advantage of. And we think like, why is this happening to me? Why is it always me? This doesn't happen to anyone else. Why am I the one who's being taken advantage of over and over and over again? And the fact is that pathway is memorized. So we have to figure out where that started, what the connection is that we're making, unwind that connection, and then try to carve a new pathway. It's not an overnight process. And I'm very clear about this in the book. Writing is not the only modality that helps us with this. There are 100 others, like therapy is a great one. There are a lot of tools within therapy, like EMDR, for example, or other kinds of trauma therapy for people who've experienced big traumas. Yoga is another one, prayer, meditation. Like there are all these incredibly effective modalities, but writing is one tool that we have at our disposal that we can use to start to uncover the ways that we've made these connections, the paths we've carved out, and really figure out like, why are we stuck in that path? And we can figure out a new path that we want to take and create that memorized sensation in our bodies.
Well, I know people are going to want to start creating a new path. It's the new year. It's a way to start saying, okay, you know what? I'm tired of just, you know, your kids act up and your response is you just want to yell. You can change that. You don't have to respond always yelling. I know because I've been there. I've done that. It is hard work. I also want to let the listeners know that you share a lot of personal stories and also client stories in here. If we had 3 hours, we might be able to get to a couple of them, but we don't. And so one that when they pick up their copy, I want them to look for Robert. That's all I'm going to say. It's a pretty incredible story. In fact, can you just give us a teaser on that with Robert?
Yeah. Well, Robert was a podcast guest who came to us and he told this amazing story of how he reached a point in his life where it was the darkest moment in his life and he realized he didn't want to be living anymore. And so he decided to write a letter saying goodbye to his family and friends. And he sat down to write the letter and the letter turned into what is now a book. And the process of writing that story changed his life. And I tell more details in the book, so definitely pick up the book and go read it. But that's the gist of the story. It's a really extreme but also incredibly powerful example of how writing can reshape the way that we see ourselves.
Most definitely. I mean, I started almost tearing up when I was reading it because him writing his story actually allowed him to save his own life.
Totally.
And that's just, I mean, you've got to go, if nothing else, read that. And then also you want to read, because I want you to talk a little bit about this, but you talk about expressive writing and you also combine it with the infinity prompt. Now, the infinity prompt, we can't go into that because, I mean, it's long, it's awesome. It's in the book, you lay it completely out, but I want you to touch on it from the expressive writing point of view.
So expressive writing is just a term that's used in the data and research around writing to help us understand the type of writing that brings this kind of change into our lives. So it's really important to distinguish this because I work with a lot of authors who want to be published to help them outline their books. And it's not necessarily that kind of writing, the kind of writing where you're trying to be published that creates change in your life. Although plenty of published writing is expressive writing and that process and experience creates transformation for people. But the type of writing that really creates transformation is what researchers call expressive writing. And expressive writing just really means that you're sharing your deepest thoughts and feelings about a subject. So this is helpful because you could take any topic in your life. You could say my marriage or being a mom or being a dad or whatever. And you could just ask yourself, what are my deepest thoughts and feelings about being a mom? Or maybe you want to choose a situation from your life that is, you know, feels kind of charged for you. You haven't fully processed it, like maybe the loss of a loved one many years ago, or maybe it's something, you know, less extreme than that. Maybe it was just like a breakup that you never fully processed or something. And you want to ask yourself, what are my deepest thoughts and feelings about that breakup? And you could just journal in response to that prompt and just do a free write for anywhere from 5 to 20 minutes. And you'll be shocked at what you learn. I have writers tell me all the time, I never knew that I thought that until I wrote it down. I never knew I felt that way until I wrote it down. This is the power of the writing process, taking us all the way back to the beginning of this conversation. is that you're tapping into a part of our brains that we don't tap into all the time. So you're going to uncover stories that you forgot about, memories that you haven't thought of in years, thoughts that you didn't know you had, and feelings that you didn't know you had. And those elements are what hold the key to creating real lasting transformation.
That is so good, Allison. I'm telling you, I'm going to be reading this book like 3 or 4 more times this year. I do love it. And of course, being a daily podcaster, I do a lot of writing. And then I also do a lot of speaking, obviously, because it goes out verbally. But I have to write it first. I really have to, you know, that thought process. And so I love absolutely everything. I was like eating it up. I'm like, oh, come on, give me more. It was awesome. Well, the one who's sitting there going, okay, I know I want to write, but, you know, my calendar, it's so packed, and I really don't have a place. Like, I know Allison must have this perfect space that she goes to a cabin in the woods and, you know, creates this harmony with herself, and it's all great. Let's be real. How do you find that time and space?
Yeah. Well, I walk you through in the book, making space in your physical environment, making space in your calendar, and then making space in your mind to get this writing done. But I want to speak really quickly to what you said about a cabin in the woods, because I think this is really important, especially I know you have a lot of moms who listen to this podcast, and it's especially important for moms. I'm the mother of a 5-month-old, so I'm like doing this for the first time and so much more clearly understanding all my clients for years who were mothers who were like, I don't have time to myself. What are you talking about? But what I want to talk about is this myth of the cabin in the woods. The myth that we have all believed about the writing life is that the only place that we can get really great writing done is if we, you know, block off our calendar for a whole week and rent this cabin in the woods and get away completely by ourselves and have no other distractions. And we just wander in the woods and listen to the birds and you know, write 2,000 words a day. That's just simply not how most writing happens in the modern world. So I just want to encourage anyone who's listening who feels like, I don't have that kind of space, I don't have the luxury to leave my kids behind for that long, or this is just not the season of life for me. You do not have to write for a week alone in the woods. You don't even have to write for an hour a day. You can write for 5 minutes a day. You can write on the dashboard of your car while you're waiting to pick your kids up from soccer practice. Or you can write for the 3 minutes before a business meeting starts. Or you can write, you know, for the last 30 seconds you're awake before you go to bed. Or you can write one sentence to yourself when you first wake up in the morning before you go, you know, make your kids breakfast. So this does not have to be long and drawn out. You don't have to overcomplicate it. And in fact, I think this is the biggest thing getting in people's way is thinking that it needs to be something that you don't have access to, rather than just saying, here's what I do have access to. I can make 5 minutes for myself every single day. I have a chair by a window where the sun comes in every morning. That will work just great. That's going to be my writing spot. And, you know, I'm going to commit to give myself this time and space each day to reflect on my life.
And that's so good that you say that, because in reality, we don't, most of us do not have that luxury of being able to put ourselves in a room, close the door and say, that's it. I'm not coming out till I got 2,000 words. We may get interrupted and may only get 50 words, but those 50 words may be powerful. I know for me, my kids joke with me. They're like, Mom, you got paper around the house. Why do you keep writing on a napkin? I'm like, because it's right there. So I have notes of napkins. That's where a lot of my ideas have come from, because they're literally right there. Maybe it's because I'm in the kitchen a lot with 5 kids. I don't know, but that's for another episode. Well, I've got to ask you, when you're looking at writing, you help so many others. How has it allowed you to really find your voice?
People ask me really often how I kind of like bounced back from my divorce so quickly. And I guess because I lived through it, I don't really think of it that way. But when I look at the timeline, I realize what they're talking about, right? Like from the time my divorce was final to the time of meeting my now husband, getting married, having a baby, like that's all happened in about 4 years, which in the grand scheme of things is quick. So my answer is the writing process. It's, I know that seems simplistic and maybe it is, but for me, there's something about really knowing yourself and understanding yourself that gives you an ability to come into alignment with what you want to create in this world. Just knowing that, like, this is what I'm here for. This is what I'm here to do. This is what I'm here to build. This is what I'm here to make. And being really, getting really, really honest with myself about that and really clear on that vision through a process like writing has helped me to create this life, I think, more quickly than I was able to create something like that, you know, 5 years ago. I think now in my life, I would be much less likely to get hooked into, I mean, I'm married now, so I wouldn't get hooked into a romantic relationship anyway, but I would be much less likely, let's say I was single right now and I met my ex-husband, I would be much less likely to get hooked into that relationship because I'm so clear about what my purpose is, about what I'm doing here, about my worth and that I matter. That has all come to me through the writing process. And for that reason, I'm really grateful for it. And it's why I'm so passionate about this and why I teach it to other people, because I think, like I said before, there are a bunch of modalities that you could use. And if I was trained as a therapist, I'd probably be doing talk therapy. If I was trained as a yoga instructor, I'd be teaching yoga, but I'm not. I'm trained as a writer, and this has been a really incredible, useful practice for me. So that's why I'm passing it on to others.
Well, we mentioned at the very beginning, you have a community called Find Your Voice. Share a little bit about that with us.
Find Your Voice is a community that's for anybody who wants to write anything. So I always say we turn people into writers and writers into authors. So if you have something you want to publish, if you're like, oh, I'm not really sure where to start with this book, we can help you with that. But if you're also like, I don't really see myself as a writer, but I would really love to maybe start a journaling practice, this conversation has been really interesting to me, then we have plenty of really easy to access digital products that you can use to get started in a regular practice of journaling. So yeah, you can learn more about that at findyourvoice.com.
Awesome. Well, we will have all that information in the show notes, and you all are going to want to pick up your own copy of The Power of Writing It Down, A Simple Habit to Unlock Your Brain and Reimagine Your Life. Well, Allison, I know people are going to want to connect with you. Where can they find you?
Instagram is the best place to find me. That's where I'm most active on the internets. So you can find me at Allie Fallon on Instagram, and I show lots of pictures of my daughter. It's mostly what I show. But I also share like writing prompts and talk through my own process with writing, and you can see my hunky husband there too.
How awesome. We're going to go check out that adorable baby and hunky husband.
Yes.
Well, before I let you go, I have one final question for you. The series is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story gifted you?
My story has gifted me the knowledge that I can overcome anything. I mean, never in a million years would I have wanted this to be my story. It's not what I set out to do or create, or it's not what I asked for. But I think I feel a sense of, I mean this in a really, I actually mean this in a humble way, but I feel like a sense of invincibility, because it's like you can destroy anything else, but you can't destroy my spirit. So that's what I think the experience that I've lived through has done for me.
Well, Allison, I know God has extraordinary plans for your life. I can't wait to see how he continues to bless you and your beautiful family. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.